We can get into the key themes of your book shortly, but one of the big problems with this story is that we face the threat of further restrictions. And that's the problem, isn't it? There's no point having freedom dangled before your eyes. You know, we're expecting most of the COVID restrictions to go on the 19th of July. But that freedom is worthless if it feels temporary.
I think it's psychologically very difficult and very stressful for people to live under those conditions. And I wonder if it's not just us, the people, but also perhaps the politicians and their advisors who are experiencing this stress and potentially acting out of misplaced fears. Mm. So I wrote an article that was in The Sun today about this state of fear we're in and about how we need a sage for recovery. Somebody I interviewed for my book said to me that fear makes recovery 1,000 times harder. And I think this is the stage that we're at of the pandemic. People are looking for monsters under the bed and around the corner, and we should be feeling much brighter and more optimistic about where we are. Look, nearly 85% of the UK population, adult population, have had their first dose of the vaccine, and 62% have had both doses. So incredible vaccine take up. We should be really proud of this world-beating vaccine program. But not only that, the Office for National Statistics conducts what I think is probably the most interesting metric we should be looking at. Like, forget about cases, they're not linked to hospitalizations or deaths now, that link is broken. But the ONS see how many people in the country have antibodies. And 86.6% of us had antibodies to COVID a week ago. This is a very positive picture. But I think people are now stuck in a bit of a self-perpetuating fear and doom loop.
Well, we need politicians to say there will be no future restrictions, that we don't have contingency plans, because if we're going to go down the contingency route, then we need contingencies for everything, including China invading the UK. I mean, it's just not how you live your life.
It's not. An idea of safety has become secondary to what living life really means. But if you focus on only one aspect of safety, there's this risk that you cause harms in other areas of society. In this article that just came out, I gave one example of pubs. One in four pubs still haven't opened their doors because the restrictions means it's just not viable. Now, pubs are, I don't want to sound like I'm just desperate for the boozers to open, but pubs are a bastion of our culture. And I think the fact that a quarter is shut is a really interesting barometer of the restrictions and the national mood. I also gave an example of somebody I know of, let's call him Robert. He went to the pub with a group of friends. And it was all booked, it's all very exciting, they want to celebrate pubs being open, and he couldn't walk in, he could not get over the threshold because he's been programmed by all the messaging over the last 15 months to be frightened. Now, he's actually had both of his doses of the vaccination too, so he has even less reason to be frightened. And I think what we should be focusing on is not the threat of restrictions dangling over our head, but how we get everybody like Robert to participate fully in life again, and we get those pubs and all those other businesses open.
Yes, and we have, don't we, as you've said, Laura, the threat of restrictions, which I think, and having read your brilliant book, you know, you'll agree with the idea that that's a form of control, actually. That's leverage from the state, the threat of future restrictions. And actually, at worst, it's somewhat abusive, actually.
Oh, I'm glad you said that. I was about to go there and I was thinking, shall I? Because even though I've written the book on it, it still feels a bit strange to say it, but I'm afraid this is a hallmark of an abusive and coercive relationship. If you're good, I'll let you out. Oh, if you're not good, I'm withdrawing your privileges. And it doesn't really make sense. The goalposts keep moving. This is abusive. This is coercive. And actually, the British public deserve an awful lot better.
Yes, they do. What do you think that my listeners should do if they feel overwhelmed by this news that we'll have five more winters of discontent? What's the best way for them to navigate this? I mean, should we just assume that this is kind of worst case scenario contingency planning? How would you suggest people navigate all of this negative messaging?
Well, that's, goodness me, that's so difficult. What do we do? I mean, sometimes I find myself feeling depressed by the constant stream of bad news. Well, on those occasions, you have to turn it off for a bit. I do think it's really important to regain agency. And I would advise people to do what they can legally and proactively to take control of the situation. Drop the things, drop the rituals of fear that you don't want to do anymore. A psychologist called Dr. Mark Antonio Spada has identified COVID anxiety syndrome. One in five people have adopted obsessive hygiene measures, or they're afraid to go out. And if that's you, it's worthwhile seeking some support for that, because that's disproportionate now to the scale of the threat. The ONS released figures that half of all people who were clinically vulnerable and shielding are still shielding, even though they've been vaccinated. And that's a pity to be so separated from normal life, from, old normal, the real normal we all want to get back to. Also, people should write to their MP. They should let the politicians know that this just isn't good enough and doesn't have public support. Recovery is getting our kids back into playgrounds, it's getting them to school, it's keeping them in school, and it's learning to live with something that's become an endemic virus to which everyone's been offered a vaccine.
And it's clearly the politicians that have, been behind all of this rather dystopian, awful messaging in the course of the last 15, 16 months, Laura. So I guess it's up to them to get us out of this. Were you encouraged by the comments of Sajid Javid, the new health secretary, in the Commons earlier this week, when he said that the 19th of July, it's not just the terminus for him, it's the end of the line and the beginning of a bright future for the country? Were you encouraged by those words?
I was encouraged, and I really want to believe that this is a turning point and a bright positive future. I think we have to grasp onto that with our mitts very firmly. But on the other hand, there has been a bit of a good cop, bad cop routine throughout the whole epidemic. And part of me was waiting for someone else to say, "Ah, no, hang on. Actually, we're going to bring restrictions back." I think the fact is this shows the signs of being a difficult winter. There are forecasts that other respiratory diseases are going to make a comeback. We'll still have COVID. And let's not forget there are incredibly long waiting lists, over 5 million. We're going to have late stage cancer, untreated heart and diabetes. But more restrictions isn't the answer, because we have to get the economy and normal life function again. What I'm really worried about is the psychological aspect to this. If there is any intent in the messaging to confuse people, to destabilize them, to frighten them, that has to stop, because those are coercive and they're underhand methods. And I think we're really living through the end point of my book, which is that fear puts a brake on recovery. To be honest, some of those advisors, when we see them on TV, I won't name names, but I feel that their anxiety is palpable. I think that they're caught themselves in anxiety, and that could be about the virus, because it's all they've been tackling for months. And they're human, we're all made of the same
And they're
psychological
obsessed with their
stuff.
legacy, of course.
And it could be that they're a bit worried, when this comes to an end. What do they do next? What is the point when you admit that it's actually okay now, and we have to confidently but cautiously move forwards? I think that's probably difficult. And that's why I suggested in this article today that we might need a recovery sage. We might need a fresh team
Yeah.
who are tasked with getting the country back on its feet.
Well, I certainly would agree with that. Laura, what do you think is going to happen in the months to come? Do you predict that freedom will come on July the 19th, and do you think we'll keep it?
I wish I had a crystal ball. I don't know. But I tell you what my big worry is. My big worry is that the people that so successfully controlled the population and elevated our fears might be skipping through the corridors of Whitehall, happy that they've done such a good job. My big fear is that the same tools will be used again next time they need to nudge us into being model citizens and make us behave the way we should. And I think that there's going to be a COVID inquiry. We all know that. But I think we need a separate inquiry into the psychological methods that were wielded against us during the epidemic, so that there is ethical oversight and scrutiny, and that the public are consulted on the methods. Because let's not forget, we pay our taxes for these things to be done to us. We deserve to be consulted on the methods, the people behind them, the impacts, and the ethics.